Welcome to another edition of the BFT Chat, brought to you by Kankedsi, the BFTonline.com. My name is Norvan Acquah-Hayford. Today we are going to be speaking to the Chief Executive Officer of the Minerals Commission, Dr. Toni Aubynn. We'll be reviewing 2016, some of the challenges that they had, and what are the projections for 2017.
Thank you very much, Dr. Aubynn, for joining us on the BFT Chat. I mean, the mineral sector in Ghana, a very vast area, gives us a lot of revenue, and we know that much has been talked about. How would you see 2016 in particular, your review of it, from where you sit?
Well, I think 2016 represented a period of some level of consolidation, coming from the slow of the 2013-2014. You could see that from production point of view, gold in particular saw a little slump in 2014 and in 2015, in fact, 2015 in particular. In 2016, we saw an edging up of gold production. We saw about 2% by September 2016. Gold production has increased to 2.9 million ounces plus, as against the 2.8 million ounces plus in 2015. We believe that by the time, by the end of the year, as of December, which numbers we are still trying to finalize, we would have produced more in 2016 than we did in 2015. We would have produced more in 2016 than we did in 2015. In terms of diamonds, that is where our challenge is. Diamonds, we've been seeing some consistent decrease in output, largely because we do not have a formal diamond mining company as we used to have in the days of GDC. Our diamonds are being produced artisanally. We have the small-scale miners who are producing diamonds on the so-called tributary system. For us. So it is not surprising that the production has not been catching up to the levels that we had before. In terms of bauxite, we have seen some good increases. I think we by September 2016, we had produced about 18% more than we did in 2015. Similarly, manganese saw about 9% increase from the 2015 figures. So there's a consistent increase in the production in output. We haven't focused so much on the lesser known minerals, which is really not good, because as a country, even though we have been praising ourselves as a mineral-rich country, which we are, yet we have focused traditionally on four of the minerals, the ones that I've just described to you: gold, diamond, manganese, and bauxite.
Let me stop you right there. Before we go into the fact that we haven't focused on these ones and how we can harness, these particular lesser-known minerals that you talk about, on the gold, we've had reports, and let me attribute it to the right source, the chamber, who working hand in hand with you, or let's say one of your stakeholders, had indicated that there were great decline in production levels. But you tell me that no, you rather had an increase in production levels for 2016. How do you reconcile that?
Yeah, I've had a chat with the CEO of the Chamber of Mines, and we both agreed that their figure was not the overall figure. This is very simple. The Chamber is an organization, it's a collection of people with like minds who are producing gold or working in the who are producing minerals and or providing services to the mineral producers and all that. So it is not every gold producer who is a member of the Chamber of Mines. We want to believe that the figure they have only reflect their membership, what their members produced. We cover everything, so their figure doesn't reflect what the country produced within the period that we all spoke about, between January and September. Their figure only reflected their membership. Of course, their members produce more gold anyway, But you should not forget that there are some other medium level producers, like the Birim, the Kibi Goldfields, Zastra Mines, and all that, who are not probably not members of the chamber. I'm not sure if they are. And even the bulk of small scale mining producers who have produced, you know, close to 30% of our gold, maybe they were not included as well in the list of producers that they looked at. So we have agreed. In fact, I have spoken with him. We have agreed that their figure reflects what they got from their membership, and ours is more omnibus, and there shouldn't be any doubt about it, because we've told them that in the future they should clear these figures from us, because it is good not to send any confused signals. If we're talking about gold production in Ghana, then we shouldn't have any confusion. We shouldn't have any doubt as to how much Ghana produced from the, I mean, we're talking about country production. If they are talking about member production, members of the Ghana Chamber of Mines production, it must be clearly spelled out.
I picked something from what you just said. 30% of our gold comes from the small-scale mining, let me put it that way. Does the small-scale mining cover illegal miners as well, especially when they probably do not use the right channels even in selling their, you know, gold that they get, or their produce they get from the ground?
In Ghana, when you want to sell gold, particularly small-scale mining gold, you don't need to disclose the source, which might change in the future, I believe. You don't need to. You know, let me draw your attention to the fact that historically, in fact, until 1989, it was outlawed to hold gold in its raw form. So people were smuggling gold. If you mined and got gold, and in fact, until 1989, all small-scale mining activities were illegal because there was no law that allowed for small-scale mining to take place. It was only from 1989 that the Mercury Act was passed, and then small-scale mining law was also passed. That is how come now we regularize small-scale mining.
Okay, now, I mean, with this illegal miners, can you vouch and say that you have all the minerals being sold in this country? Because before, we've heard of the fact that some of these people sold their gold using Ivory Coast, Togo.
Well, you cannot. When people smuggle, they are doing something criminal, so they will hide. So if those at the border are unable to stop them, then sitting here you may not be able to. But I even if that happened, it would be a significant portion, because now they are free to sell the gold at a price that they themselves determine. Price of gold is not determined by Ghana as a country. So these producers are very smart. They are very in tune with, you know, world market price. So that, I don't know whether it makes sense having to smuggle your gold through Ivory Coast or Togo, especially given the risk associated with that. I mean, I would not completely say that it's zero, because some people also want to take risks. Some people are very, they want to take that risk that they manage to send gold outside the country. Some may be foolhardy to do that, but by and large, most of them sell their gold through here, because now there's no restriction. When you have gold, you can just hold it like this, walk to a gold buyer, a legitimate gold buyer, licensed gold buyer, to sell and get your money. So I hope that would not be the order of the day. But we've seen increasing production. If you go back to 1992, in fact, the small-scale mining gold production was insignificant. It was just a dot in the graph of gold production in this country. It was just a dot. Now we are talking about percentage that are significant. You know, maybe one third of the country's gold being produced here through the small-scale mining sector. This is a combination of, as I've indicated, the legitimate ones and the illegitimate ones. But at least it is sold through the same conduit. In the future, I believe the issue of traceability will be an issue, because people have questioned who are involved in this type of illegal mining activities. For instance, people have questioned whether there are people under 18 years being involved in the production of gold at that level. People are looking at whether those who are producing actually have the blessings of government in terms of having the licenses and all that. And so some ethical bias are raising those questions. And that is making life of the main producers a little bit, the main legalized producers, a bit uncomfortable, because when they are going to sell their gold, they always have to explain themselves. So I think in the future we will be looking at tracing the sources of this gold, and to ensure that those who are not into the brackets of legal gold producers would try and come into that fold. It is easier to be that, so that you don't have an issue of selling, because it will not be too long when buyers will be questioning where you brought the gold. So maybe it's a way of encouraging illegal gold producers to come into the fold of law.
If I want to allude to your question to legalize these illegal miners, that they become legal, to ensure that when buyers come and they put questions as to the source of their gold, you'll be able to buy. In 2016, you ruled out certain, fine laws to ensure that we can capture these illegal miners, legalize them, and then when they even finish mining at a place, they could, make sure that we reclaim the land. Where are we with this particular one?
Yeah. First, it's an old requirement that when you mine, you should reclaim. In fact, when they apply for a license, the small-scale miners, they indicate that they would reclaim the land. So something that is not even new, it's just a re-emphasis. But what we rolled out were a series of legal, amendment to the laws, that one of which would invariably criminalize illegal mining, and also allow for the confiscation of equipment used in illegal mining. These were laws that were passed last year, clearly detailed in its outlook, providing sanctions for indulging in illegal mining. So that's there, the laws are there, but the laws must be enforced, the laws must lead to prosecution, there must be prosecution before punishment. So I believe that the law is just under a year. So hopefully we'll see the implementation. And don't forget that when somebody does something wrong, it doesn't take the Minerals Commission to go and arrest that person. It takes those who see them doing the wrong thing to draw the attention of the police or the security forces. They are required, they have the power to enforce those laws and to arrest those who perpetrate illegal mining, just as anyone who is perpetrating an illegal activity. It doesn't lie on the regulator. Well, there are a few situations that are different. For example, the forestry sector, they have prosecution power. They have the power to arrest, actually. They even have a para, I don't know whether you can call it paramilitary group, trained to do that. The Minerals Commission hasn't got that. So it is important for everybody to know that when people are doing illegal mining, sometimes they do it at the glare, the full sight of some security agencies. It makes the Minerals Commission a little bit helpless in what to do in that area when we have gone ahead to push for laws to be made and all that. But beyond that, I've become so convinced in my mind that we cannot use only the laws to effect improvement in illegal mining sector of this country, because this has been on for a very long time. We have allowed it to fester into a very critical situation. We are looking at 1.5 million people, Ghanaians and non-Ghanaians, I believe, involved in this type of business. you won't have enough police to even police them. You won't have enough soldiers to even look at them. So I have grown the desire and the belief that we need to combine all these legal issues, education, policy, and technology. And I think that our surest bet is the use of technology, along with the education, with policy and the law and all that. Because we have seen in this country that when some people offend the law, you have others coming to say, oh, these are my own people. I mean, I've heard people say, oh, these are my Chinese. I don't know how they got them. You know, some people will say, oh, please help, don't do this, but because these are my people. And the problem is not only politicians. I must say they are part, just as I believe my staff may also be part directly or indirectly. But almost every Ghanaian living close to where mining is, or even outside, we are indirectly complicit in this. One, let me tell you, you may have a traditional leader who either knowingly or unknowingly will give a piece of land for mining. I have been careful to say unknowingly because some of them believe that because they are the custodians of the land there, they still have the right to give out land for mining, not mindful of the fact that the minerals in their raw state have been vested in the president on behalf of every Ghanaian. So some chiefs tell you, oh, but this is my land, I give land for farming, I give land for building and all that, so why can't I give land for mining? And so they do that unknowingly because they don't understand the law. So we have to educate them to understand that they don't have the right to give out land for mining. They can give land for other things, not for mining, because the minerals there are not for they are not for any individual. They are for Ghanaians under the vesting of the president. You see, so that is one. There are some who give money for the work to be done. They want to buy gold. There are some who pray that people who go and do illegal mining must get more gold. You know, there are some who see that lands are being dug, water bodies are being impacted, but they don't do anything when they have the power to do something. You remember about 2 or 3 years ago, the military guys who wanted to stop some illegal miners got drawn, made their souls rest in peace. You know, they're just trying to stop them. So we are collectively responsible. I mean, I have said many times that sometimes even in our electoral campaigns everywhere, every year, I mean, well, wherever there is election, we are not strong enough. We don't marshal the will to say we will stop illegal mining, but we will encourage small scale mining. We'll make sure small people come into the fold of small scale mining, and we'll do A, B, C, D to bring small scale miners under control. So the laws are there. Anyone who says we should regulate small scale miners probably has forgotten that the laws are there. We do have laws, we do have regulations, but there are people who on their own don't want to do the right things.
Very good, fine laws in the books. Very good, fine laws in the books. But in 2016, if I recall, you opened that window for illegal miners, the people we call galamse operators, to come and get themselves registered and make sure that they are legalized, either in small groups or even individually, especially when you had done certain amendments to the law. Where are we with this particular one? And how many people have been able to register so far?
Yeah. You know, we are talking about over 1.5 million people engaged in this exercise. So when we gave those instructions, we went ahead to organize some people. If you go to Obuasi now, especially because we had land available, we registered close to 5,000 illegal miners. They were illegal miners. Some of them had actually invaded the Obuasi mine. Now they are working. Some of them were working, in fact, most of them were working for people who were not involved in the actual mining. So they got some freedom by us, you know, helping them get land, securing grounds, and they are, as I speak with you, working, and our people are, you know, registering them. They are doing all the legal things that will make them work in places that they will not be illegals. You see, so we have within, I think it was just the end of 2016 that we came up with that idea. So far, we have, I believe close to 5,000 people. That's not a...
Out of the 1.5.
But I mean, you cannot... But it's not everybody who is...
Give them a deadline at
no,
the
no,
time.
Yes, we did.
Have you changed your stance?
No, we haven't. We haven't at all. Point is that's why we have registered so far. And it was just this thing came up in November. And we are only in January. So just 3 months. Remember that it is not everybody doing small-scale mining who is illegal. There are people who have registered, they seek assistance from us. In fact, some people have been involved in corporate social responsibility, some small-scale miners, they do. So we have good people who are doing the right thing. If you go to Bibiani, the immediate environs of Bibiani, you won't see illegal mining there because we have properly registered legal miners group who are working, and they actually police the area. They will not entertain illegality in the area. And we thank the administration there, the police, and other the chiefs around the area who have tried to fight this along with the Minerals Commission. So this is a collective responsibility. We are doing whatever it takes to minimize illegality in that sector. It has never been easy anywhere. And I'm not saying because of that, it shouldn't be easy for us. Countries like Suriname are struggling seriously with illegal mining. Peru, you go to the net now. Recently, I read a report on what they are trying to do, and it's also chaos. You go to Colombia and other places. Now, we have proposed something that I haven't seen any other country propose. We have proposed the review of our the definition of small-scale mining.
Categorized.
Exactly. Because when you look at the law, what the law says and what we see in reality, it is clear that reality has outpaced the law. The law was done with good intentions because at the time the law was first made in the 80s, people who were involved in illegal mining at that time, because they hadn't been legitimized, were using simple implements. Some were using the pan to just get the gold dust. Some were using pickaxe shovels and then a spout and then just draining water on a jute sack and you get it. Very simple implement. And I can tell you, they were getting gold in quantities that were for the weight of blade. You go and say, I got 10 blades. Today I got 10 blades. You can weigh 10 razor blades. Very, very light. Some were getting £1, and £1 would be something like this. Now, small-scale mining operators, they talk about kilos. That is why the commission has decided that we are going to redefine, because the law, part of the law actually allows us to recategorize mining. So we are going to go under that window. In fact, we've done the draft and everything. We have received the first approval to go ahead and do the engagement with the public. So that has been done. Once the engagement is taking some time and some of these things. You like date and time and everything.
Because last year you talked about going to do this engagement. And
yes.
By now
Yeah. We have done some engagement. I'm sure that's why you even got to know about it. If I hadn't been speaking about them publicly and been trying to get feedback. But we also want to take them directly to the operators, to the chiefs and other stakeholders. There were a few delays, logistical issues sometimes. We would make the arrangement and something will happen, we have to change it and all that. I think especially around election time, you see that almost everything ceases. You try to do something and then something is happening elsewhere, so you have to stop your activities. So now that we are clear, we have a stable situation, I think we can go ahead now without being stopped to do the engagement. I think once we have redefined, because the same law that was thought of as artisanal mining is regulating mines that are almost like medium-scale mines. The same law that regulated shovels and pickaxes and simple implement are regulating these trommels and chamfans and excavators. Why can't we have something similar in the small scale and even a medium scale system, where before you register, you show that you have a geologist, you have a mining engineer. Even if that mining engineer is not that much experience, I'm sure whatever he learned at the university would help him support a small scale mine. So we are doing that. We have recategorized this so that those who want to still use the simple pan and spout and all that, they can continue to do that at the level of artisanal. And then there's another level which is small scale, which may have more space other than the 25 acres that a small scale miner should have, which they use 25 days to devour and leave the grounds there. We might expand it. And then also expand it further to medium scale. We have seen in reality that other foreigners participate in this business, which is supposed to be for Ghanaians. That is the reality. In fact, they overwhelm us even. So what do we do to ensure that we contain that situation? Two things. You can either sack the foreigners and do that all the time, which you can't. There are a lot of diplomatic implications, a lot of other things. If you look at our quarry mines, even though quarries are actually reserved for Ghanaians, and even limestone mining, all our they call it restricted licenses, are actually left for Ghanaians. There is also a window under our law to allow for partnership. In the case of quarry and limestone, the foreigner must indicate that they will invest in excess of $10 million.
Are you looking at the same thing for this medium scale?
Precisely.
$10 million.
We are not talking about the figures, because we haven't engaged. We cannot, if I say that, it will mean this is what I'm asking for. But it could be the $10 million, or it could be that a partnership should have Ghanaian having majority shareholding at all costs. Regardless of your investment, the Ghanaian must have the bigger shareholding. These are things that we are looking at.
So if you found out that the Ghanaian who is, let's say, a majority shareholding is actually holding in trust for the foreigner, what would you do?
The laws are there not because people won't break them. People will break them. Now, if you are caught, then the laws deal with you. If you are caught fronting, and if Ghanaians are struggling, we are always saying that mining has been given to foreigners and all that, and then we ourselves will be fronting for them, then it's a problem. But I believe Ghanaians won't do that. If they do and they are not seen, they haven't stolen, maybe. But if they do and they are seen, the law must take its course. And we must allow the laws to work. We must allow laws and institutions to work and without interventions, plenty interventions. So once that is done, I think there will be some sanity. People will be afraid that if I do this thing and the law catches up on me, there will be no savior anywhere. When people feel that, don't worry, I know somebody here, so don't worry, that is where we have the problem.
Now, just before we move away from gold, because I want to look at the diamond area and the lesser known minerals that we have in this country, just before we wrap up this interview. Anglo-Gold Ashanti issues going to court, arbitration, going for arbitration outside the country. Why are we with that?
The matter has not been taken out of court yet, and really it's not for me to answer that, because the Minerals Commission has not been taken to court. We are the chief witness to the case. I think it's more the government of Ghana, which we are part though, as a commission.
You are representing government.
Yes, but the long and short is that the matter is still there. But I believe, I've always said that some of these issues, you look at exactly what was the problem. The problem was the illegal miners who were there. We have managed to successfully take all of them from that place.
Not even a single one.
As far as we are concerned, they have confirmed that they've all moved, and they were the people who have been the beneficiaries of, unfortunately, they are the beneficiaries of the of the land there, very close to the AngloGold Ashanti Obuasi mine. Now, is it the Obuasi mine we want to develop, or it is the attention that we want to dissipate? It is the energies that we want to dissipate. Is it that we want to focus on developing the Obuasi mine so that we will have the shared benefit as investors and as a country? And I think as a country, our interest is getting the mine developed. I believe that for AngloGold Ashanti, their interest should be getting the mine developed. I'm hoping, only hoping, that after the key challenge has been removed, the issue of the court case would be addressed differently. I don't know exactly how, but my gut feeling is that there's no justification for the continuation of the case.
You have a feeling that it would take the case out of arbitration or the court, let me put it
that way. I think it would be the right thing to do, especially because it is no one's interest to spend energies and time trying to go to the U.S. for arbitration hearing, and it's not cheap. You're going to pay, both sides, you're going to be paying to consultants, to other people. There are situations where you have people who are going to war and they will sort of take over your mine. These are illegal miners who went there and they've been moved and they're not causing any problem. So, and the mine is available. In fact, as I speak with you, they are doing some work there, So why do we have to waste time?
You can assure them that nothing of such that happened in 2016, where these people forcibly took over parts of their mine, will happen again.
It shouldn't have happened in the first place. In the first place, if you have a house that you're living in, nobody should come and say, I don't have a house, so I'll forcibly come and live in your house. That is not right. You see what I mean? So it shouldn't have happened in the first place. But it did happen, and we have resolved that. I am hoping that both government and, in particular, AngloGold Ashanti will take their security very seriously. Because the protection of the mine, is your property. So the primary protection is yourself. It is having a house, your primary protection. The government has broad protection for everybody. And where it goes beyond your ability to protect, government will always come in. And I know government will always come in when there's a requirement to do so. I am praying that it doesn't happen again. It shouldn't happen. It is not in the nature of Ghanaians to behave the way it did. But in a way, they were also Ghanaians, so we didn't have to go through a violent approach to take them off. Remember, Ghana is a signatory to the so-called, why did I say so-called? To the voluntary principle, voluntary principles of mining and human rights. So that actually enjoins government and even AngloGold Ashanti, which is also a signatory, to use non-violence means in addressing these things. So I think we are in a better position to focus on the mine than on legal wranglings.
What is the challenge and how do you think we can address it?
I think that it is just the attention that we have paid to gold, because gold has given us quick returns. And then gold sector has actually been, gold is almost everywhere in this country. It's very easy to mine. And then given that historically gold was a key mineral that helped. Going forward, it has made us a bit more dependent on gold, which is not fair. So when gold price sneezes, all of us catch cold. The recent reduction in gold prices actually affected government inflows, both from foreign exchange side and from internal revenue side. So you would want to spread your tentacles. You want to diversify so that you can put attention on the lesser known minerals. And the lesser known minerals are often minerals that you can use in the country. You can use as an industrial foundation. For instance, limestone. Limestone, it could be the basis of various industrial productions. The aggregates, they can be basis for construction, and Ghana is constructing. Ghana is under construction. We are constructing harbors. I mean, we are expanding harbors. We are constructing roads. We are constructing buildings and all that. So they actually directly go into our economy and so on. But there are other minerals that we haven't been able to harness, maybe because of lack of adequate infrastructure. For instance, the iron ore. We have iron ore. We need power. We need the railways. You know, bulk minerals normally thrive well in terms of production by having rail haulage, which we don't have and which we must have. So these are areas that we need to relook going forward. But I agree, solar salt. Solar salt, it says white gold, because in Ghana is among the few countries in the world that have good quality, potential for good quality solar salt. In West Africa, it's Senegal and Ghana. We are seeing increases in the application for salt licenses, which is good news for us. We've seen application for quarries. Quarries, there have been quite a number of quarries in this country. And sometimes you see foreigners also partnering with Ghanaians. And so it's not too bad. We're getting there. We see some activities in the limestone area. You know, the diamond cement, the Ghana cement company, Gassem, Savannah cement, and all these, because of their coming into Ghana, we now see a significant competition for limestone concessions. I mean, these limestones have been in Ghana for how many years, only God knows. Not much interest was shown in the beginning. You know, we were even importing limestone from, I think, Togo or something like that. So now we are seeing some activities in these areas, but we need to push. We have a lot of clay. Clay is a very important mineral in this country if we want to go into the ceramics and other, even ornaments, detergent and all that. Remember that the tiles that we import from China and Italy and everywhere, we could actually produce tiles. Yes, can manufacture them here in the country. So the potentials are there. We need to encourage our local and Ghanaian investors to look at that for long term, because sometimes people like quick returns.
Very finally, I mean, as we end this interview, which among these lesser known minerals would you say we must, as a country, invest in it? Even if we have to bring foreign investors, we need to get them so that we can be able to have it also, you know, projected as we have done for gold.
My bet will be salt, solar salt. Because solar salt, it's in abundance. It will never get finished, you know, because it's in the sea. You just go to the sea, you pump the seawater, you do some processing, even though it takes land, you know, its land uptake is quite big. Other rock aggregates that we haven't, you know, paid attention to, the granites and things like that are very much available. And then the limestones for the purposes of cement production.
That's how we end another edition of the BNFT chart. Just to remind you that it's brought to you by the BNFTonline.com. You can find all our stories and videos on our Facebook page and also on our YouTube channel. My name is Norvan Acquah-Hayford. Goodbye.